infrastructure and data flow and how data makes its way through the OI system to the user, and what happens to it beyond that. I'll try to go quick since we're already a few minutes in. Is it in presentation mode? Does it? I can. Yeah. Yep. That ought to do it. Maybe. It's not showing up on the screens though. Okay, I'll let you work on that. So I'm going to talk about data flow and products, data review, some of the periodic reviews we do or would like to do, next steps beyond that. So OOI, as you heard yesterday, the Ocean Observatories Initiative, NSF funded, there's 7 different arrays. Two of them are suspended or at least in partial suspension state. But there's 57 different platforms, 31 mobile assets like gliders and AUVs, over 1,200 instruments, and we've got 4 data evaluators and myself to look at 2,500 data products. So there had to be some procedures put in place in order to review that amount of data and make sure that it's getting through the system. There's a number of different portals and ways to access the OOI data. Nobody's able to see any of this yet. Send to all doesn't work. Well, anyway, many of you have probably been to the oceanobservatories.org website. That's the main way to get to a lot of information about OOI. Some discussion up here. OOINet.oceanobservatories.org is the way to get the data portal, data catalog, and asset management metadata. This is fun. We can all be presenting. There's also an ERDAP system that's still being set up. A lot of people are familiar with ERDAP because it was developed by, developed by NOAA. It's pretty standard across the oceanographic community. And then we've got a few other archives of shipboard data collected during OOI cruises. And then the quality control database, and I'll talk about that in a minute. Cool. All right. This colorful piece is the flow chart that sort of describes how data makes its way through the system. There's different types of data from OOI. There's the real-time or near real-time telemeter data that goes to satellites. So from a platform, well, from an instrument integrated onto a platform to a satellite and then to the shore server. Recovered data is the same type of data or sometimes a more dense version of the data that's picked up when the platform is recovered. And those are brought back to shore and the data are loaded onto a server at each institution. Alternatively, there's the electro-optical cable that the cable array uses and that sends data back in real time. And a similar process, it goes to a shore station and then gets, both of those get then pushed to Rutgers where they're stored on local servers and backed up. And then, so the raw data, and I'll talk about what that means in a minute, that data is archived and stored in perpetuity. It's also parsed. It's sent through parsers that break it up into packages of data. And that parsed level zero data is also maintained. And then it waits for someone to make a request. So the data is processed on demand, which means when somebody goes to the site and requests a specific data product, gets run through algorithms that apply the calibration information, attach metadata from the database, quality control flags are applied, and then it gets delivered in NetCDF or CSV format to the user on their interface. So that's how it makes its way through the system. There's a couple different data product levels that I just mentioned. There's raw data, which is as it's received from the instrument in instrument format, or in the native sensor format of the computer that the instrument is plugged into. So it's not always what you would expect it to be, but you can get to that through the raw data archive, and there's links to that on the oceanobservatories.org site as well. Level zero data is unprocessed but parsed, so packaged up into an engineering or a science stream. So those are, that data is also available and persisted and archived, but you wouldn't probably know what to do with it in that form. And then there's level one and level two data. Level one is processed, calibrated in science units, like temperature in degrees Celsius. Level two would be a derived parameter that comes from multiple instruments or a single instrument, multiple data, multiple parameters like density or salinity. So those are the terms that we use within the project, and they're I think derived from originally NASA terms. So currently all the available telemetered and recovered data are being ingested. There's some backlog because there was an ingestion issue a couple weeks ago, but I think it's all being caught up now. Currently storing over 340 terabytes. This is a couple months old. I need to get the new numbers, but including 100 terabytes of HD video data from the CAMHD unit at Axial. And that those video data also stream in real time, so you can go see that. That was just turned, so that's on now. And then I'll talk about annotation in a minute. So we annotate known issues. All right, so data review. The data team, myself and four others, well, three others now that Friedrich has decamped for UW, monitor the operational status of the system, ensure the availability of the data sets, try to make sure that the data meet quality guidelines that we set, and report on operational statistics and data availability, quality, and issue resolution. Among other things, the data team has also been roped into testing of functionality, doing the ingestion of the data itself, so taking the data files and running it through the parsers, which is a somewhat manual process, manning the help desk, so answering user questions and things like that. So in addition to that, there's automated QC procedures. There's six algorithms that are in the system. Only three of those, I would say, are fairly reliable. Global range is pretty standard. It's like the Cortad gross range test, but it basically looks at whether the values are reasonable for global oceans. And these produce flags. They don't screen out any data, but they are attached to every data point to let you know whether they pass or fail a test. And these refer to lookup tables that were assembled by the project scientists. So yeah, anyway, global range, there's a spike test that looks for spikes that are outside of the neighboring values, and a stuck value test to see if the instrument is stuck at a particular value. Local range trend test and gradient test are still, I would say, works in progress. And I hopefully 2.0 OOI will look into that and make sure that they're doing what they're supposed to be doing. They require a little bit of looking at data ranges that are outside of what a user would request. So I can get into that later if you have questions about those. But the system, as it's the compute-on-demand system, has some issues with the way these tests were written. All right, so like I said, the QC tests don't remove data, but each parameter that you download has a corresponding QC executed and results variable in an integer value. We're also need to work on ways to make this a little more user-friendly to figure out, but you can find information on how to interpret the variables that come with the data on the oceanobservatories.org site at that link. And then there are annotated data status categories. So the data team has gone through and added annotations, which is how we mainly communicate with the users. Annotations tell you for a range of data whether the instrument was functioning properly or not functioning properly, whether it was turned off for a particular reason. Anyway, so there's different values that could be applied to a data range, and they roughly correspond to the Cortad codes. And they show up when you do a quick plot on the OOI net site. I don't know how I'm doing on time here. Probably taking too long. So yeah, you can see annotation text for a particular data stream when you go to the catalog and go to the annotations tab that's outlined in red here. Right. In addition to those automated tests, there's human in the loop QC that needs to be done. So the data team went through and did sort of a first run to make sure that all the data products that the system is supposed to create can actually be created by the system, and then started going through and looking at the backlog of all the data, and that's going to be a years-long process. That's going to extend into 2.0, as well as doing, you know, QC on the new real-time data that's coming in. So we try to create some quality timelines and add the annotation text. The data team also created a QC database that is basically something to check the system against what should be created by the system, all the data products that are supposed to exist. And you can go there. It's a valuable resource that it's open access, so you can go to ooi.visualocean.net and take a look there. There's statistics on availability, status information, a cruise data checklist that is still sort of being put together. And it was designed to be a check against the system, but also to provide some review capabilities that we needed to do our jobs. And that's an example of what the data availability timeline would look like. There's, I think, like monthly and then daily availability for every instrument in the system. Like that. That's the daily one. And then in addition to that, there's also been some quality control applied to different data sets that we've found issues with. Like Seabird sent us some CTDs that had a bad pressure sensor. So when you deployed the second sensor, all of a sudden there was a huge pressure jump. So we had to go through and Friedrich did some calculations because basically they said, oh yeah, the pressure sensor's bad. You just need to apply this correction that varies depending on temperature and the instrument itself, but yeah, go for it. So they didn't give us a lot to go on, so Friedrich took it upon himself to go through and calculate the offsets and then apply it within the system. So that's been corrected and annotated where necessary. But there's also drift, biofouling. Craig and the group at OSU has seen some biofouling on the oxygen sensors, and they've been working on ways to both prevent the biofouling and also ways to catch it when it starts to occur and annotate it and potentially correct it if we can. Instrument damage, there's been video issues. So anyway, these are the kind of things that the humans are needed to look at for quality control that maybe an automated system wouldn't catch. And then we try to produce report. Well, we're contractually obligated to produce reports for NSF. And report things in Redmine, which is our trouble ticket system. It's also where help desk questions go, so that we can track that stuff and track closure. All right. So then, in addition to all that, the system is still being improved and added to over time. I guess I'm a little. Well, I started 5 minutes late, so. So there's still a few derived data products that need to be added to the system. This is some examples of the BOT-PT, the bottom pressure tilt unit. There's still some level two products that Bill Chadwick would like to have added, or is giving me a look because he knows about this. And there's some other, like the broadband hydrophones. There's no way to scroll through and look at the hydrophone data or listen to the hydrophone data. You have to go to the raw data archive to find that stuff. So we'd like to see that added to the system since it was originally in the requirements that it be there. So the data team has been part of adding capability to the system. Doing additional science evaluation, looking at environmental variables, vicarious calibration using glider flybys and things like that need to get done. Yeah. There's community data sets and tools you can find on oceanobservatories.org. So people have submitted things that they've done with OOI data. And there's some really interesting stuff there. And then OOI has partnerships with IRIS, NANUS, NEDC, where OOI data flows into those systems and can be accessed there. That's an example of glider data in the glider DAC. So these are the kind of things that we would like to see continued into 2.0 and improved on. So in conclusion, there's a large amount of high-quality data coming into the system. Data review needs to be the primary focus going forward. And data review is accelerating as we have these tools now. And so there's short-term and long-term goals for improving it, and OOI is providing a curated, consistent system for delivering data and metadata to the community, and hopefully you'll find it useful and help us improve it. So that's the data team at Rutgers through September 28th. And if you have any questions, these are some links and my email. Thanks.
Thanks, Mike. All right, so a couple things. Forgot to mention this before Mike started talking, but try to log into the Jupyter Hub because that's what we're going to be using next. We want to make sure everyone is on there. Now we're logging all in at once, but hopefully that is all working. So go ahead and log in.